So Larry, could you tell me a little bit about your show?
Well, I certainly can. What would you like to know?
When you're out painting, do members of the public give you a hard time, or what's that like? Because you're usually in fairly public spots.
No, very rarely give me a hard time. I've told you this before, John, that actually I feel part of my mission to sort of be out on the street painting. It's a small entertainment for the public, but it is part of my job, really, and it might be my most essential job is actually just being somebody who paints out in the street, and I'm not trying to sell the things I do out in the street. I'm just there painting. And I do talk to people occasionally. Every once in a great while, somebody will annoy me, but in general, I'll interact with people and try to be positive. And occasionally, there's some young person who's going to be a painter, and they come up and they're very enthusiastic. I think when I first did it, when I was 18, I was a little embarrassed to be painting out on the street. That's sort of long in the past.
What are you, in your 20s now? How old are you?
I've been painting for a few years beyond my 20s, yes.
How old are you, Larry?
64.
I first met Larry Francis in 1979 at the Pennsylvania Academy. I was a student, and Larry, a 1972 Academy graduate, was having a show at the Academy's Peel House. I loved his work, introduced myself, and we have been very close friends ever since.
Will you still need me? Will you still feed me when I'm 64?
We used to trade poses for each other. Larry would often have me doing things that I would never do in my own life, such as smoking cigarettes or being a second story man in a heist. There simply is not a better human being in the Philadelphia art world than Larry. Artists are often racked by jealousy and pique. Not Larry. He never complains. And he never badmouths other artists. I have learned more about how to live a creative life from Larry than from any other person. But he is not infallible. It turns out that he misspoke when he told me he was 64. In fact, he's only 63.
Will you still need me? Will you still feed me when I'm 64?
Well, let's look at some of the big paintings to begin with. So what's this one?
This is the painting from Essington. It's sort of this little park out there that people kind of lounge around. But it's a beautiful, peaceful place right at the edge of the city. You're sort of looking south towards Wilmington. The tide is coming in. My dad used to keep a boat actually near this place, so it's kind of familiar.
How did you decide to arrange the figures the way you did?
I think I knew that I was going to put figures in this right from the beginning. With time and contemplation, I'd make little cutouts and stick them on the canvas and move them around and wait till things seem to fall into place. This is a painting from the canal up near Phoenixville. I spent quite a few weekends, and this is about the furthest away from Philadelphia I've painted in recent years. This was a nice, quiet little spot. People would be canoeing by all the time. For some reason, I guess the last year or two especially, I've been painting these more watery subjects. I always like to have the human element in the paintings if possible. I took snapshots of figures canoeing by, and that's essentially how I put the figures in this. I generally paint on site with the little paintings or the large scale work. I had to keep repainting the reflection over and over to kind of decide on what type of day to get. Some days were really windy and the reflection gets shattered completely. And I kind of like the mirror-like effect of this image. My friend Liz and I went up there and painted. It was a wonderful little spot. We'd stay overnight in my van and sort of camp out.
Can you tell me about the Rittenhouse Square?
This is the exact same view right here. And I do believe in this case, it's not always the case, but I did start the small painting first and got the idea of, you know, sort of doing a larger scale and including more figures. Looking back through a lot of my older work, I noticed something that I've done over and over, which is to paint people walking through the landscape unconscious of the beauty around them. And in this case, there are three people, two talking on cell phones and one looking at some kind of electronic device. The one fellow is staring possibly at the woman, but they're basically talking to other people at the same time, which is maybe a common sight these days.
Yeah, this is Larry.
I paint a lot of architectural hard edge objects, and this has a lot of that too, but it does have a very organic tree as the sort of center of the painting. And I'd like to do more of that.
Well, I'd say there are quite a few different artists that have influenced me, painters of light. Like Monet was an early influence. Probably his earlier period, maybe more than his later period. But American painters, of course, like Hopper and Winslow Homer were big early influences. Maybe a sympathy also with the Ashcan school painters. Partly it's their urban subject, which I do a lot. Their capturing of city life, which I've tried to do. John Sloan, who started out in Philadelphia, was an influence early on. Not a painter that I look at a lot now, but I think in terms of sympathies, we have something in common. Hopper has probably been an influence to many figurative painters, although uniquely hard to top in a way. His intention of painting the American scene and the things that felt natural to him, even though he very definitely comes a lot out of plein air tradition of French painting. The realism of some of the French painters, I think, influenced him a lot. In recent years, I've had a great fondness for Poussin, especially his landscapes where the figures figure as small parts of the landscape. But I like the idea of his trying to capture these little stories within the landscape. And the invented nature of some of the landscape is interesting, something I haven't done very much of, but I would like to do more of, a reinvention of a modern city. My skill in the gouache did originally derive from oil painting. The thing about gouache is that it dries quickly. It doesn't move far when you push it around, so physically it's a bit of a different challenge to work in it. You can't endlessly paint over it, which I tend to do with oil, redrawing and repainting. So you have to be kind of concise in how you lay things down. Part of, I feel, of a skill that I do have is for nailing the way color feels as light hits it. And I think in gouache and landscape, it's pretty easy to make these little slabs of color and put them down. In a way, I learned gouache by doing figure studies in gouache. And I actually do say this to my students, that there was sort of an unconscious nature in terms of the quality of these, because I wasn't concerned about showing them. It was just for the fun of doing figure drawing and painting. When I started doing gouache as opposed to drawing the figure, I was trying to paint the figure in little chunks of color as opposed to lines around the edge of a figure. And it's as simple as that, and it works pretty well for painting buildings or architecture. And as I've done it, I've gotten a little bit better at doing the sort of soft, ephemeral things that you see in nature too. And hopefully I'll get further as I keep working on it. I love being out looking at nature. I really have always felt that art is like a little shadow of like what you experience in life. The reason I love seeing paintings at the museum is it's like a little word from someone else who has sat down and looked at something and is passing it on. I just feel joy of seeing light on the side of a building. If someone gets a little piece of that, that's a wonderful thing. I think beyond that, very few paintings can make you cry, but if they could, I think they should be able to do that as well. The craft and care that someone puts into it can really move you. I looked at a painting at the Boston Museum this summer, Gauguin's large-scale painting, a sort of summation about life in a way, one of his Titian paintings. And the tenderness with which it was painted, along with the sort of boldness of the color, is just moving. And I think any painter, if you can do that to a person, that's a worthy pursuit.